welcome to this episode of Earth Talks. We're coming to you at a time when there is an environmental catastrophe playing out in the northeastern part of India. There is an oil spill in Tinsukia district of Assam, and it has caused large-scale devastation. It has affected the Maguri wetlands as well as Dibru-Saikova National Park. And with me today to discuss what's happening in the northeast, particularly what's happening at the site itself, the larger issues of how we report on catastrophes that happen, or any news, in fact, coming out of Northeast India. I have with me today Karma Pajur. He's the editor-in-chief of East Mojo. I also have with me Chandrani Sinha. She's a Guwahati-based journalist who reports on issues related to gender, politics, and environment. I'd like to thank both of you for taking out the time to join us on Earth Talks. I'm going to start with you, Chandrani, because you're someone who's actually been on site, at the site where this catastrophe, I've been told, is continues to play out. The fire is still on. It started on the 27th of May. So what did you see at the site, and how bad is the devastation?
Okay. The gas and the crude oil emission, it started on 27th May. And then we were just planning to reach the site because I want to do an environment story like on the wetlands. So just like 4 or 5 days ago, the fire started. There was a big blaze, there was a big blast, and then the fire suddenly like started flaming. So when I reached there, it was almost at 9 p.m. at night. So we were crossing, when we were crossing Tinsukia, we could see a red light, like we were following that, and we reached the place like Baghjan. So it's very interior, like we have to cross tea gardens and to reach there. So when we reached the area, we could hear the hushing sound, very hushing and very like kind of peculiar noise was there in the area because of the fire which was burning and also the emission of gas, and there were tremors. So already the army was cordoned in the area, and we were not allowed to cross a certain line. So we took some pictures from far, and then we have to leave because strict security for strict security reasons. And next day morning, again we went there. When we went there, I met few of the locals. They took me to their house and they showed me like how big cracks have been made like in the walls of their house, and their glass were broken. And they took me to their garden. And one interesting thing which I saw is that people, the workers, there are still some workers, we were plucking tea leaves from the garden. When we asked them like why, like because this area is also like it's devastated now, the nobody is buying the tea, or there were layers of oil in the tea plants, so why you're working? So they told me that it's for our, like we are hungry, so we need food, like for that we get wage, and because of that we are working here, so we can't leave it. And also the small tea growers, they themselves were working in their garden, so that maybe a chunk of tea which was not harmed, they can pluck it quickly and they can leave the area. So this is the situation on ground as a whole. We could also see small ponds. It's like a layer of crude oil been there, so in that area. And there was continuous tremor. But the reason, like they say that tremors are more during night than day. So the locals, they are very worried during night. They can't sleep. The smell of the crude oil, like they feel nausea, the headache, continuous headache, irritation, like in the stomach, upset. And also in older people, they are saying that they are facing problems of memory loss. So these are the problems they are facing on ground. Yeah.
All right. Okay, so Chandrani, what you're saying to me is that it's not just, you know, we think of it as an ecological catastrophe, but there's also people living in that area. There is a livelihoods issue. There are tea estates all around. I've been told some of the people have been moved to a nearby school. because it could impact their health as well.
Yeah.
But I think there's a larger issue here. Had this happened in any other state in India, I mean, of course, there's no dearth of crisis reporting at the moment, given that we are in the midst of a pandemic. So it really, I mean, there is so much happening in the media. But I'd like to bring in Karma here right now. Karma, you were, you know, you're a former colleague from CNN News 18. You're an award-winning journalist. I know you as a rock star reporter, really. But what made you give up mainstream media and set up this organization, this online digital portal called East Mojo? Did you feel that there was a vacuum in terms of reportage? And what made you take on this tectonic shift?
It's that question that I faced every time I went back to the Northeast, saying, you know, why don't you cover Northeast enough? When I was with CNN News 18,
yes.
Every time I would go there for any talk, anything like that back home, people would ask me, why don't you cover Northeast well enough? That was a point when I started thinking that maybe I should come back. And my promise to the Northeast was that at one point I would return back to do some work there. And that was the point I decided, okay, I need to go back. And I felt a huge vacuum between what is covered and what is not covered. So there is a huge gap. So we are, you know, divided from mainland India by the chicken neck, but the chasm or the divide that there is there between on-ground coverage and what comes out in the national media is huge.
Yes.
National media is represented only by a few people now, few of their own correspondents in Guwahati. Rest of Northeast India is not covered at all. And it's very convenient now. What the national media is doing is that, you know, they take some of our journalists who are there in Guwahati and other states, and they pay them whenever they want an in-depth report. That's the only time that our journalists are remembered. And after that, they are just left to fend for themselves.
Mm.
So I thought that there was a need. Yes, we are an independent organization. Yes, we've got financial constraints, but at least a change is being made where we are chronicling everything from day one, including the case that you're talking about today. From day one, we've been reporting on it. We've also done a couple of in-depths on how, the impact has been overall on the wildlife sanctuary and the people around.
And what have your reporters observed, Karma, in that area? I believe that you had also sent reporters there. And what did they come back with?
So we have a journalist in Tinsukia who reports, and he was there, right there. So right from day one, he's been reporting on the blowout. I think the attention of national media was caught, when the visuals became attractive for them because a large fire with a blast blowout. It became attractive. Even then, most of the media were just doing a cursory coverage of what happened on the ground. Okay, it's a blowout. But nobody was really seeing the impact that it had on over 7,000 people who are living around that oil well. And also in that wildlife sanctuary, which is famous for migratory birds.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not even that. Even before the fire, the gas leakage, the toxic things that were coming out had already impacted large parts of the wetland. That was not reported.
Yeah.
We did an in-depth on the impact. We also followed it up with a beautiful photo coverage in photographs with an independent photographer who was there and who chronicled it to show exactly the extent of damage on the ground. And I think that was much, much needed. We continue to follow with more in-depth. But the only problem is, you know, that just very few people interested in reading news like this, I think. But the larger awareness is not there. It's only when it hurts them, when it hurts the viewers, is the time they read news such as this. Or it has to be exceptionally sensational. And then they come back and tell us that the media is being sensational. So
yes.
Double-edged sword we are dealing with.
So, in fact, Karma, that brings me to a point of I'd seen something someone had shared on Twitter about, you know, the Northeast saying that, you know, when it suits us, the resources of the Northeast are, we are told, are national, but our catastrophes are not national. And I think it was, you know, a telling tale of how one has reported on this tragedy. And obviously, through East Mojo, you're trying to bridge that gap. But can I ask you, how challenging is it to do that? How challenging is it? We have the News Minute, for instance. We have several now niche online digital platforms, whether catering to a topic or to a geographical region. How challenging has it been to set up East Mojo and to keep it running?
I think the biggest challenge, of course, has been money, to be very blunt. That's the one thing that keeps an organization going. You know, as far as funds, investment, money is concerned, today nobody wants to touch a media organization, even with a barge pole. So yes, investment is something that we need terribly. However, because I have a very good co-founder who knows this area, she comes from a finance background. So she does see that, you know, we are floating. So we are already 2 years old. We are strong to go for the next couple of years. But that is the biggest challenge. And the other, of course, is that not being really able to afford quality journalists. We'd, of course, love to hire great journalists who are there on the ground, but an independent media is left wanting, you know, when it comes to paying the right compensation or the right salary, even to send. Because you see, whenever a big tragedy like this happens, you have the national media, mainstream media, who immediately hire the local good journalists who are there, and they will pay them a large sum of money for their report. So that is certainly attractive. And that kind of limits us, but does not limit us really. So that's a kind of constraint.
Right.
And people realize that, you know, that is not going to come, because mainstream media comes to remember Northeast maybe 4, 6, or maybe 12 times a year. And that's it. And after that, you know, they're not interested in stories from the Northeast at all.
And in fact, that brings me to a point which Chandrani had shared with me. To my mind, when I was speaking to her when she was, in fact, on site, and she said, can you put me in touch with editors who will help me tell my story? And I found that so sad, because here you had a reporter who was on site. It was a big story. To my mind, it's a big international story as well. The fact that we are several days on since the catastrophe broke out and the fire continues to blow out, it's a biodiversity hotspot. This is a crisis which should be reaching international headlines. So Chandrani, what are the problems you faced while trying to get, I would say, the legacy media or even the mainstream media to take your stories?
So what happened, I will tell you. I pitched 5 international media organization platforms and they denied. They say that this is not what we are looking right at this moment. Might be one of the reason is COVID, because financially they have also gone back. Like, they are not doing too much stories like outside their, like where they are stationed. So yeah, another thing is that to understand the problem, one have to understand Northeast. Yeah. So everyone, like the editors who sits in Delhi, like who asks us to do story, like, so they're mostly, they think like, okay, fine, like Northeast is something like from here. They don't know the distance between Guwahati to Mizoram, maybe Tripura or somewhere else. So they want the story like you connect with people, you do it in 1 hour, 2 hours, and then you submit it. Like the competition, the race of providing the story, to submit the stories more in regards to the quality of the story. Mm-hmm. So in most cases, most of them don't want their journalists to reach the ground, because it will take more of a like financial strain for the organization, or more of a like compensation for making the journalists visit it. So they want a shortcut of it. So when I asked like, let me do it for you, because I will be anyway like reaching the ground in some days. So there is a psyche of maybe they have to give me the travel allowances with my honorarium or whatever. Like, so I think that is the thing why most of them back off. Also, While I talked to a few of the foreign editors, they told me that India is not the largest oil like drilling agency. In India, like 30 metric tons something is the ratio. So
I get it.
In that way, so this doesn't make a big international story, but yeah, might be later on, if the after effects of the entire scenario is something very damaging, then we can take it as a climate change story, something like
that. Right. So but, what you're saying to me is that, of course, given the background of the COVID pandemic, the fact that media houses are already stretched, I've reported on the Northeast as well, and I'm somehow more cynical. I mean, to my mind, even if there wasn't any pandemic, I'm still not sure if it would have continued to make headlines as it should. So let me now turn to the last leg of this conversation. Karma, if I can bring you in, what are the changes do you want to see in journalism, in as far as policies are concerned, so that we can report on the Northeast better? What would help you do your job better?
I think, the first thing, the biggest change would be if people started reading, and reacting to stories, that would keep journalism alive. That's the single biggest thing. If they love the stories, if they share the stories, if they make a move, so that's going to change. The second thing is, of course, for independent journalism to survive, we need people to support us. We'll not be able to be running with the minuscule ads that we get from algorithms, which are given out by Google or Facebook or any of the other platforms. That is just peanuts, absolute peanuts. If we are to survive, we will need advertisements. So that is one change that must be done. We also must remember that in the Northeast, the challenge of distance will always be there. Some of the editors talk about tyranny of distance. The tyranny of distance, as Chandrani says, is there in the Northeast also. For us, it's not easy to reach from Guwahati to any part of Mizoram or anywhere immediately. We just commissioned a documentary on the Dihing Patkai, the coal mining issue, and we are working on in-depth and a documentary on that. And that costs a lot of money just for travel, stay, a lot of logistics have to be worked on. So these challenges will remain. But I think if people start reading, supporting independent journalism, that would be it. I mean, the rest of the stuff, we will manage.
Chandrani, what are the suggestions you would make to an editor sitting in New Delhi?
So, same as Karma told, like, please read about Northeast and then design the stories, because it's very difficult on ground to suddenly go and then do the stories as per their needs. So is concerned. So also take suggestions from people who are working on ground, the reporter, because it's not possible for us to go and do the story immediately, because we need some buffer time because of the connectivity and also the connections. And yes. Another thing I would suggest is that social media has done a lot of damage. Like, now everyone thinks they are kind of like citizen journalist, and they I have few friends, they ask me that you are on ground, give us the breaking news, like we will put on social media. So this is not the way. Like, until and unless you do a research on the complete thing, you come out with a story, nobody will read it, because nobody has that much of time to read a complete story. So I need to cooperate, like the editors to cooperate with us, to also like extend their hand and make us understand, okay, fine, if this is not the story, then I'm sitting on the ground, tell us like how to go with the story, which will be the main headline. Like, if we are not getting a way out of it, like, please help us to do that. So I think these are the small things. There should be a good communication between someone on the ground and someone sitting on the editor's.
Some great suggestions there from Karma and Chandrani. I hope for more power to both of you, to, you know, that you're able to do the things that you do, report on the issues that you do, because they're very important. And also because of the fact that, as I said, there is an ecological crisis playing out there, and yet There is a silence from the media. I think it was trending perhaps just for one day, as you spoke about social media. There was a day when, as Karma said, the visuals were very dramatic, when everybody was sharing those visuals, and then we went silent. But just to remind people who would be watching this show, even as we're speaking right now, the fire continues to blow out of that well. It's still not been plugged. So hoping for more reporting, better reporting from Northeast India. Thank you so much, Indrani and Karma, for joining us. This is Bahar Dutt signing off from Earth Talks.
Thank you so much.